Happy Sunday. Amen. And it is a happy Sunday. The school year is about to begin, and I can't help but I feel those words from the Lord of the Rings, Return of the King. I feel like I'm on the rock with Sam as I look at it all. It's good to be here with you, here at the end of all things. That's the way I feel a little bit. As the summer ends and this new school year gets ready to begin, please let your prayers be mighty. We need them. Let's go to the Lord in prayer as we go to his word this morning. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for this place where you gather your people together, and thank you for your people being here and being present. May we all have hearts that are truly ready and prepared for worship. Lord, I pray that that we'll truly try with your help and with your strength to give all, everything, body, soul, spirit, committing it all in our worship of you. May your spirit guide us through your word that's for us this day, and may you be working within us, preparing our hearts for this message, for the observance of the communion, for the time of fellowship later, and the food too that we get to enjoy together, all of it, Lord. May all we do and say today bring glory and honor to you. You are mighty, and you are beyond anything that we could ever receive from this world. So we thank you, Lord. Thank you for your love, and thank you for your strength. Thank you for the peace and the joy that you give us, and thank you for this word that we get to look at this morning. Thank you for the truth of that word. Boy, do we need your truth. So as always, commit this time to you. It's yours. And may we be changed. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So, last Sunday, I just stuck, with one verse, Romans 12, verse 1. I said that there is a great possibility that we might simply launch off from verse 2 this week. And that's it. That's what we're doing. So Romans chapter 12, I want to begin though back in verse 1, but let's read verses 1 and 2 of Romans chapter 12, the words of the apostle. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship, and we spent a great deal of time talking about worship. What is true worship last week? Continuing verse 2, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will, which is a verse that we teach to our young children in Awana. So it's a good, well, at least in Truth and Training we do. So it's a good one. We know from Jeremiah chapter 17 verse 9 that the heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it? And so in that verse, the heart is synonymous there, in a sense anyway, with the mind. You know, we don't know our own hearts. In that sense, we don't know our own minds. Our thoughts are so elusive, and our thoughts are so unpredictable at times. And in fact, they can often be corrupt and wicked, even the best of us. Jesus said back in Mark chapter 7, verse 21, for from within, out of men's hearts, come evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. And the first thing Christ focuses on in that which is from within is, as you see it there in Mark 7:21, evil thoughts. From out of men's hearts come evil thoughts. And certainly a majority of our thoughts are not accepted in the ears of God. You know, I think we all experience that at times. But in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, we see that Paul is exhorting the believers to be renewed. He says, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, and then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. So we can't know our own hearts. We can't know our own thoughts. They're so unpredictable and elusive. And yet, when we're saved, that is, when we're born again, regenerated, something happens. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 16, tells us that believers have the mind of Christ, the apostle says. We have the mind of Christ. That's powerful, right? A little short phrase there, a little term, the mind of Christ. That is a powerful thing. As Christians, we have the mind of Christ, but yet we don't always use this mind. And that's part of the challenge. So do we have a renewed mind? Do you have a renewed mind, a reformed mind, a renovated mind? You know, some of those words you might see in other translations. The New Testament teaches that it's possible to have a new life. It's possible to have a new heart. All of that without a new mind, which is very strange. Many people absolutely possess new life, and they're saved, and they're born again, and yet they still carry around with them their old minds. It doesn't make much sense, right? But I'll put it to you like this. I don't know if you've ever been completely pure in your heart regarding motive, regarding sincerity, you know, about something that you were going to do, but even though your heart was in the right place concerning that, your mind was all confused. I think we've experienced that, you know. I don't know if you've ever been like that, but I think we all are, at least at times. So this morning, what I'd hope to do in the time that we have is look at the mind at creation, look at the mind before salvation, and then look at the mind once more after salvation, and then we'll try to look at the renewed mind and how you can get it, because that's what our Lord wants. Our Lord wants for us, the church, the people of God, to be free in our minds. Always. This morning and always. We're meant to be that. So, I could have probably broken this up into several messages, but let's see what we can do. Let's look at the mind there at creation, because when you look at the book of Genesis, it tells us that man was created in the image of God. And God said, Genesis chapter 1, verse 31, God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. That includes the mind, right? It was all very good. God wanted to make a mind in his own image that was perfect, and that was Adam's mind. His mind was absolutely designed and meant to enjoy God and to glorify God with his thoughts and with his actions, because those actions will spring forth from the thoughts, from the heart, from the mind. And if we go back to the beginning, and then we suddenly look to the Garden of Eden, there's some trouble, right? Because in the garden, we see how Satan approached Eve, right? In Genesis chapter 3, and Satan's first instigated attack came to humankind through the mind, right? Through the mind. You know, did God really say this to you? Right? Is that really what he said? It's exactly the same today. Exactly the same. He hasn't changed the enemy, his tactics at all. And so Eve was not attacked in her heart, but she was attacked immediately there in the garden, in her head, in her mind. And Adam as well, for that matter. Not so long after following. So, a principle right at the very beginning of this wonderful book that we have to read is that the mind is the battleground where Satan contends against the truth. And that's important for us. It's important for us to recognize. I probably mentioned, I did a series back in... a series back in 2021, I think, titled it A Fight to the Finish, talking about spiritual warfare and the pieces of the spiritual armor that God has given us. And so I think it was during that time that I mentioned John Bunyan and his book called The Holy War. And in his book called The Holy War, I'm getting some confirmation from my brother back there in the booth. Thanks, Bruce. I appreciate that. Thank you. So John Bunyan, his book, The Holy War, he was imagining the human being as a castle, right? And he talked about the forces of Diabolus, Diabolus being the devil coming against the city of Mansoul. Mansoul was the name of the city. So if you imagine the forces of the devil coming against this castle, which is your life, the battleground that's at the front of the castle where the battle for man's soul is fought. That battleground is the mind. That's what we're talking about. So if you think about the whole person, in other words, as a castle, if you think of the whole person as a fortress made up of the will and the spirit, the human spirit, the will being what you act with and the spirit being what you relate to God with, that's what the devil wants. That's what the devil wants to get his hands on. So, evil spirits, when you see evil spirits within the Word of God, sometimes they're called unclean spirits, sometimes they're called impure spirits, deceiving spirits, lying spirits. You know, the thing is, those spirits strive to capture our will so that we might act poorly, so that we might act wrongly. And then they also want to capture our spirit so that we'll also relate wrongly or poorly to God. So, but if evil spirits are going to capture this castle, this fortress, which is our lives, they have to come across an open field. And that open field is where the battle is waged for the seizing of a person's spirit and a person's will. And that open field that's before a man or a woman is his or her mind. And That's why these words from the apostle here in Romans are so important. So important. You know, if they're going to capture the castle of a person's soul, they have to win on the battlefield of the mind, because the thoughts there are what influences our actions, what influences our will. You know, thoughts are what influence our relationship with God. That's our spirit. So Satan knew at the very beginning of time, where we see that serpent slither into the garden, and he knows now that if he can conquer a person's mind, then he can conquer the person. If he can conquer the mind, then he's conquered the soul. If he can get into your mind, he'll just take your head off, is the idea there. It's the imagery there. So our mind is the weakest link, and it's the first temptation to man and to woman that was instigated by Satan, because he came to the mind. And what was that temptation, by the way? You know, looking back at Genesis chapter 3, the temptation was to eat of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that knowledge that would have been possessed there, the mind. It's the battleground. And every temptation that's ever come to humankind has been through the mind, right? Every communication that any force of darkness, any evil spirit, or satanic influence has made with humankind has been through the mind. It's that weakest link. You know, think about it. Even there in the garden, and think about what we said. You know, when God made man in his own image, you know, when God made man and woman, you know, Eve's heart was sinless at that point. And yet, she received Satan's thoughts. You know, he needed the mind first, and he needed it before the heart. It's amazing. It's really something for us to consider. And so, as believers especially, you know, the very fact that you might be, your heart might be right, my heart might be right, but that's not enough. It's not enough. Because God wants your mind as well. You know, he wants new minds. He wants saved minds. He wants those minds to be renewed, renovated, reformed. You know, that's what he's looking for. You know, before we're saved, there's actually two aspects to our minds that are very obvious. And the first is what we refer to and have been looking at a little bit as we go through Romans, that old nature, right? You know, that old nature being the old part of us that has a sin appetite. And that old nature, that sin appetite, just wants to indulge in the things of the world and of the flesh and of the devil. That's that old nature. And the Bible says that carnal, that fleshly mind is very hostile toward God. Right? So if God's going to save our minds, then God has to alter our minds. He has to change our minds, right? So, and to an extent, that happens when we're born again. I'm looking at people who are born again, you know, because when you're saved, what do? You know what you do. We talk about, you repent, right? You know, and that repentance if you just look at the original language, you know, repentance just really means a change of mind, right? A change of mind. You change your mind about Christ. You change your mind about God. You change your mind about sin. And then you turn to him for salvation. But then that mistake that many people make is that they think that once they're saved, well, that's it. Repentance ends. No. This is daily, friends. It has to be. Repentance, a change of mind, is a daily thing. Daily. There's a changing of the mind that's going on and on and on. We have to do that daily. We have to. You know, we're up against the world, the flesh, and the devil. It has to be. So listen to what Paul says to believers. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 22 and 23. Ephesians chapter 4, beginning of verse 22. You were taught, he's talking to believers, you were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds. Right? If you don't have a renewed mind as a Christian, then that means that your mind is still operating in that old thought pattern that you had before you were saved. You know, and maybe you wonder from time to time, as I think a lot of people do, you wonder, why there's no victory in your Christian life. And it may very well be the fact that you just don't have a renewed mind. Your heart might be in the right place. But what about the mind? You know, you're saved, your heart is right, but what about that thought process? The old nature's still there, and I think there are a lot of believers who just struggle because, they don't realize that they still have that old nature. And if they feed that old nature, it's just going to rise up. And it's true for any of us. If we feed into that appetite from that old nature, it's going to come up. It's going to surface. And, and the way we feed it is through our thoughts. So before we were born again, before regeneration, not only are our minds subject to the old nature, but our minds are also subject to the forces of the evil one. We can't underestimate that aspect. We know again from the book of Genesis that evil established there at the very beginning. It's a very deep relationship with the minds of mankind right there in the garden with Adam and Eve, and it continues. Satan is still influencing the minds of unregenerate people, of unconverted people. In Ephesians chapter 2, let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4, beginning in verse 3, the words of the apostle. And even if our gospel is veiled, it's veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. So the Bible says that Satan, the God of this age, as we see there, is the one who blinds the minds of unconverted people. And then in Ephesians chapter 2, beginning in verse 1, Paul says to the Ephesians, "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us who lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath." And that basically means that that Satan, those forces of darkness, those evil spirits, impure, unclean, deceiving, as we read within the Word of God, active in both the Old Testament and the New, are working still in the lives of unbelievers. And we're talking about that, the influence that those spirits can have on the minds and the lives of unbelievers. Very clearly spelled out for us, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, beginning in verse 3 and continuing through verse 5. "For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ." We're wrestling with spiritual matters here, with authorities in the spiritual realm, right? We're wrestling with these spirits that are imposing Satan's authority on people's minds by putting into their thoughts all sorts of things, diabolical influences and impulses. That's the wickedness of this world. They influence other people to rise up against the knowledge of God. And I think what Paul's saying is that everything that's against the knowledge of God certainly has its origin with, that evil and wickedness in the minds of men and women. So before a regeneration, the unconverted person deals with his or her own nature in the mind, and then also, in addition to that, also the influence of that evil and within the spiritual realm. also affecting the mind. What about after it? What about after being born again? What about after regeneration? Well, even though repentance occurs at new birth, the mind itself isn't completely free. None of us are perfect, right? Oh, I hope you don't consider yourself. No, none of us are perfect. None of us. At salvation, there is a whole lot of sanctifying to be done. A whole lot, right? To sanctify simply means to set apart. And we talked a lot recently in Romans about justification, but we also referred a little bit to sanctification. You know, the moment we receive the Lord Jesus as Savior, God sanctifies. He sets us apart for himself instantaneously, certainly, and forever. But even though we're positionally sanctified in Christ, we aren't totally free in our minds from our old nature and from our old thought processes that we had when we weren't saved. And we're not totally free in the mind from, the influence or the oppression of evil, for that matter. You know, we're not. If we were, then there simply wouldn't be verses in the Bible like 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 3. But I'm afraid that just as Eve was deceived, Paul's words, but I'm afraid that just as Eve was deceived by the serpent's cunning that I referred to in Genesis chapter 3, right? Your minds, he says to believers, may somehow be led astray from your sincere and pure devotion to Christ. So it's very serious. It's super serious that Satan blinds unbelievers, yes, but Satan also deceives born-again believers, right? And this is after regeneration. We can experience and will experience, if we're truly saved, the onslaught of the enemy that's in the mind. And it's where that's where it gets personal, right? Because the question then comes, well, how is your mind? How is my mind? How's your thought process? And how's my thought process? You know, our minds can be filled with all sorts of uncontrollable thoughts as believers. You know, is that your mind? You know, if you have uncontrollable thoughts, you know, but we have to know that God made us to control our thoughts. This is encouraging. Right? You know, it's a lie of the devil to tell any person created in the image of God that they can't control their thoughts. I tell you, and you probably see a whole bunch of people in the world who feel like they have no control at all over their thoughts. Right? And, it's not meant for us. We should know this. Okay? It's just a lie of the enemies. We're meant to control them. Maybe you really honestly have a truly difficult time controlling your thoughts. You know, I think we all do at times, right? Certainly we have anxious thoughts. I can tell you with school beginning days, there have been anxious thoughts. You know, I don't think I've slept very much these last couple nights. Those are anxious thoughts, you know. But sometimes we have other thoughts. Thoughts of hatred, thoughts of rage, thoughts of lust. The Bible is very clear. If you have thoughts of lust, it's adultery. If you have thoughts of hate, it's murder, just like the act. Romans chapter 7, verses 21 through 23. Looking back at Romans chapter 7, beginning in verse 21. Paul says, and very personally, he says, so I find this law at work. When I want to do good, evil's right there with me. For in my inner being, I delight in God's law, but I see another law at work in the members of my body, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law at sin, at work within my members. That was the old flesh, the old nature, the old Adam, the fallen Adam in him, and it affected his mind uncontrollably, right? That's the idea there. He didn't want to do, he says it, he didn't want to do and he didn't want to think these things, but he found himself thinking and then doing. You know, is your mind affected uncontrollably at times by some of these things that we see mentioned within the Word, by lust, by hatred, by greed, by envy, by bitterness, and on and on and on. You know, maybe you have other types of thoughts, condemning thoughts, compulsive behaviors, personal conflicts with other people, spiritual struggles, maybe you have despair in your life, and these thoughts overcome you at times until, you know, the problem is if these thoughts keep on coming, we find ourselves dominated by them, and they end up controlling our emotions, and if they end up controlling our emotions, eventually they manifest themselves in our actions. And it's hard. So what does the Bible say? It says, listen, believers, be warned, be on guard, guard your mind, guard your heart. You know, because what you allow and what I allow into the mind, it has ramifications, it has consequences. And that's why the devil wants your mind. It's why he wants mine. It's why he would want the mind of any believer, right? You know, because we have to remember that battlefield before the great fortress of the will and the spirit, you know, the mind there, it's that spring from which all of our behavior flows. So if you and I, if we can't control the source, then we can't control the stream. If you can control the source, then you can control the stream that flows from it. And of course, the devil wants our minds. Sometimes our old flesh gets hold of our minds. Romans chapter 8, looking back there, verses 5 and 6. Romans chapter 8, beginning in verse 5. Those who live according to the sinful nature have their minds set on what that nature desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit, they have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind of sinful man is death, but the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. In other words, I think what Paul's saying is that whatever the mind sets itself on is what that person will go after. Don't think that the things that you think about don't matter. Of course they matter. Because nobody, you know, don't think they don't matter because nobody sees them. They still matter, whether people see them or not. You know, if you or I adopt some sort of pattern of thought, it'll eventually manifest itself in our emotions and in our behaviors, if it's left there unchecked, right? I think it's said, you know, sow a thought, reap an act, sow an act, reap a habit, reap a character, sow a character, reap a destiny. Right? So, you know, how is our minds this morning? How are our minds? Is your mind frenzied this morning? Is your mind disturbed? Certainly there's people this very morning in our communities who have minds that are just wrecked. You know, they're just broken. And it could be that if you're suffering from any of those things, that you just don't have this renewed mind that Paul's speaking of in Romans chapter 12, verse 2. It could be that you're still working in those old thought patterns of that old nature, or it could be, like we mentioned as well, that we're just being deceived by those spirits in the spiritual realm that are lying and very deceiving. You know, evil spirits just operating in the minds of believers, but they can only operate if we give them the opportunity of doing it by giving them a foothold. You know, listen, again, I'll say it. God created people as the sovereign of their own minds. And even with the fall, men and women can still have control over their thoughts. They can. This is good news. That said, admittedly, sometimes unconsciously a person opens their minds up to things that are harmful, and the devil does get a foothold, and we don't even realize that. Sometimes a person, on the other hand, does it consciously. You know, they're just pushing open the doorways, you know, just opening up the door to danger and dabbling in things that they probably shouldn't be. The occult springs to mind right away, but then any other ungodly or wicked things that are more seemingly benign things than that. And yet the devil and any spirits that are impure and unclean can have an influence if we give them an opportunity. I think all of us at some point, even in our Christian experience, there's been times where we've given the devil some ground, right, in our lives. You could probably think of the time, that exact time when you gave the devil a foothold. I know exactly. I know absolutely exactly the times when I've given the enemy the ground. And maybe you remember that as well. But we don't do that. We can't do that. You know, but if you don't know about, and we're not concerning ourselves and thinking about the mind and the spiritual warfare that's going on around us, how will we ever have victory? We have to have a victory. God's given us victory. Let's talk about the renewed mind. Let's do this. A renewed mind is a mind that is completely, completely, completely cooperating with the Holy Spirit. And, you know, listen again, Paul's instructions to believers there in Rome: do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, and then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. And friends, you and I, we are not in the good, pleasing, and perfect will of God. And, you know, and we'll know it, you know, if we're, you know, not living with a renewed mind. You know, we have to recognize, this is going to sound terrible, but we do have to recognize that our minds are not normal, right? They're not, you know, it's not the way it was as creation. Is what I mean. You know, God had it set this way, and then the fall came, and things aren't quite right. So it can't be completely right. You know, you and I have been saved, but, you know, maybe you're still holding on to that old thought pattern of the flesh, so you need a renewed mind. Or, you know, maybe, you know, because of the things that you've opened up in your life to the enemy, giving him that foothold, your mind's not even the same as it used to be, in that sense. You know, I don't know if you can remember a time when you didn't think the way you're thinking now. If so, then there's a sign that things aren't quite right. You know, can you remember a time when these things, you know, didn't plague you, when things were going well? You know, Paul says that we're not to be conformed to the world at all, but we're to be transformed. So conform here is from a Greek compound word, and I did not write it down. So I don't know if I can remember it off the top of my head. Suske matizo, I think, or something similar, but it's made from two other Greek words. That I do remember. One of those words was soon, the other word was schema, and when you do put it together, it means to form or to fashion together in a similar way. So it has this context of a craftsman who makes two identical objects at the same time. That's the imagery there. So the idea here is that humans fashion themselves after something. So we see a choice there presented in Romans chapter 12, verse 2. We can either be identical to things in the world around us, or we can be identical to something else. But the Bible teaches us that Christians are to be identical to the image of Christ, right? Is what we find. So the word transform there, it means changed. Obviously, the word used for transformed in Romans chapter 12, verse 2. This is really interesting. It was interesting to me. I hope it's interesting to you. But it's actually the same Greek word that's used back. We looked at this in Mark chapter 9, verse 2. It's the same word for transfigured. How awesome is that? So, you know, if you think about what that transfiguration looked like back there in Mark chapter 9, we might get a glimpse of what we're to become. So how are we to be changed? Well, it's by the renewing of our minds. So the word renewing, like I mentioned a few times already, it means renovating. It means reforming. You know, we're changed by by renovating our minds. And if you renovate a house, you have to what? You have to demolish the parts of it that you no longer want. You have to tear it out. And you have to tear it out often with some effort. I don't know this by personal experience, but I've watched enough television to know that this is what happens, right? You know, this is similar to the renovating, I think, in your mind, because we have to do what? We have to tear out and we have to demolish that old part of our minds and our memories. So how do we do that? Well, I think the first thing you need to do for that renewed mind is to, we're going to come to the table, I do promise, we're going to get there. When we do this, we're doing it in remembrance of him. You know, you have to apply the power of the cross to your mind. Everything that we're remembering in regards to the sacrifice of the Savior. You know, we believe that God can save us from our past sins. We believe that God can save us from hell. Praise God. You know, but how is it that we can't believe that God can save us from a depraved mind? He can. He can. And he will if we come to Calvary and we just realize, as Romans chapter 6, verse 11 says, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Friends, this is the key. When Christ died, your old nature died. When Christ died, my old nature died, and I'm dead to sin, and I'm alive to God. Right? And you can say the same thing. I hope, you know, your old thought patterns that control you and plague you have been put to death with Christ on the cross. This is good news. You know, there's no longer any power in them. And the only problem is that we may, you know, you and I don't consider them or reckon them as dead. Right? You know, and effectively, if we're doing that, we're just trying to breathe new life into a corpse. You know? What good is that? They're dead. They're dead. And the devil wants to lie to you and to me and have us believe that those thoughts are alive and well. That those patterns are alive and well. And they're not. They're not. That's a lie of the devil. They died with Christ and they were buried with Christ. And praise God, when he rose again from the dead, he left them behind him. That's the truth. That's what the Bible says. That means, good news, you're free. I'm free. This is the best news. You don't, as we come to this morning, you don't need to get free. You're already free as a believer. We are free. So maybe the only problem there is faith. We have to believe it. We have to believe it. You know, maybe you're just not believing what God has said and what God has done, but believe it. If you do, you'll know. You're free. By faith, we apply the power of the cross to our minds. And absolutely, I know you've applied it to your soul in a sense. And you know and you're applying it to your forever, to your eternity, and to your sins. But, you know, we also have to, in addition, as Paul's saying, we have to apply it to our minds. We have to. That's what we need to do. We believe the truth of God and we don't believe the lies of the devil. Jesus said, John chapter 8, verse 32, that you'll know the truth, right? And the truth will set you free. And it has. And it will continue to do that. And, you know, you believe what God says, and right? The devil's just a liar from the beginning, and he'll lie to you every day of your life if you believe him, right? He has no problem. But we have to believe God and not the lies of the enemy. You know, it's like every day there's two mail carriers, right, who come to your mind. And one is the devil and the other carrier is God's Holy Spirit, right? And they're both carrying packages, right? They both have something for you. And the devil has a package full of lies, yes? And the Holy Spirit has the book of God. And it's as simple as this. If you are in Christ, which package are you going to receive? Right? Which one do you want? Which one are you going to refuse? Shut the door. I don't want that, right? It's as simple as believing God's word over the lies of the devil. You and I choosing the truth. And that's why you have a helmet of salvation. The helmet of salvation that I preached on how many ever years ago, right? It's going to affect our minds. The only offensive weapon that we have in the armor of God is the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, the truth of God. So do you believe what God says about you, or do you believe what the devil tells you about yourself? Right? You know, if you and I were to, and I would encourage us to do this as believers, just, you want to read the Bible anyway, just go through the New Testament, find out what you are in God and in Christ, because it tells you, and just let that, you know, just let those scriptures just flow over your mind and believe the truth. That's the truth. That's where you and I will find it. Apply the power of the cross to your mind. Believe the truth of God. Don't believe the lies of your devil. And control your mind. And you're like, I can't. I just can't control my mind. But if you apply the power of the cross to your mind, and if we believe God's word, right? And we can certainly control the mind that he's given us. It's from him. And what I mean, maybe I should have said this a while ago, what I mean by controlling it is taking authority over it. And God's given us that. You know, it's your mind. Your mind does not belong to the devil. Can I tell you that? It's your mind, God-given. Just like it's your heart, God-given. You know, and so it's only with permission, that anything harmful will come into your mind. I need to get us to the table. Let me, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. We demolish arguments that every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. Friends, do it. Arrest the thoughts in your mind. Drag them. If it's kicking and screaming, you know, whatever the case, drag them into the presence of Jesus Christ. Drag them into the light of Christ, whatever they are. You can do this before you even take up the elements this morning. Just do it. You know, that's what we're meant to do. Have we ever had things just like Paul, have you ever had things just come into your mind, you know, just as a flash, and you think, well, where did that come from, right? You know, and it angers you, it disgusts you, it appalls you. And even in your most holy moments, in those wonderful moments you're trying to have before God, you have these terrible thoughts that come in. Maybe blasphemous, maybe perverted, I hope not. But they come. Where do they come from? They come from the world, they come from the flesh, they come from the devil. You know, but when those come, take them captive, Paul says. Say, nope, you're not going there. You're not going there. By the authority of Jesus Christ and the power of the blood, I bring you into the presence. I'm going to drag you into the presence of God and his holy light. We can say that. You know, you confess it to the Lord. Use the word of God, the sword that you and I have. We have it. Use it. Use it. You know, whatever one is most appropriate for the moment, that verse that the Holy Spirit gives you, it has power to it. Use it. Don't believe the devil. You've got the power over your minds to arrest those thoughts. Every thought that comes in, you can analyze it and expose it, and then dispose of it if it's not godly and it's not Christ-like. We have to do it. Why? This is war. Right? This is spiritual warfare. These spirits are real, and our flesh is real, and we're not going to, you know, live up to it. You know, we're going to end up losing out in eternity. We don't want to do that. We can control our minds, right? These spirits aren't going to go away. What is the book of in Revelation chapter 16, what do we see coming out of the mouths of the dragon and the beast and the false prophets? We see three deceiving spirits in the form of frogs. And, you know, they're coming right out of the mouths of that evil trinity. And they're in the book of Revelation. And they are looking to continue to deceive. It's not something that's going away. We have to be on guard. We have to be able to control these things. So we want to apply the power of the cross of Christ to our minds, believe the truth of God, not the lies of the devil, and dedicate our minds to the truth, because there's work to be done. And we have to be proactive in this renewal that Paul's talking about. We don't allow our minds to be passive, because passive just means we're just lying back and letting things happen to us and to our minds, rather than making things happen and being in control and deciding what happens, because God's given us that. You know, we don't want to have lazy minds, because daydreaming can be a very dangerous thing, because we can allow all those unchecked thoughts to flow through our minds, and then they become prey to the enemy and to his forces. So we need to be, as believers, a bit ruthless in a positive way, right? We don't allow our minds to be passive, but we wash our minds with the word. We dedicate our minds to the truth. You wash your mind with the word of God. We read, we study, we meditate, and we memorize God's wonderful word, right? We have to. Are we reading our Bibles? Right? We don't even have a hope if we're not reading our Bibles. Choose to think good thoughts. Claim God's peace. It's yours. If you are, it's absolutely your blood right in Christ. Absolutely. As the church, I have to tell you that. I need to finish this up. This is a message for us, because, he wants to set us free. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 9. Don't be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your thoughts to God. And, good news, the peace of God, which is beyond, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, this is the good stuff. Whatever's true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you've learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Luke chapter 4, verse 18, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that captives will be released, that the blind will be seen, that the oppressed will be set free. The Lord Jesus has given us this message this morning, just launching off of Paul's words there in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, because he wants you to be free, and he wants me to be free. And we want to get to the table, take these elements in remembrance of him. As you do that, remember that you can go to the cross and apply this power. You can believe God's words, not the devil's lies. You can take control of your mind and your life in the power of Christ. And, you can also determine to think good thoughts, like we just read there, and claim God's peace. And then suddenly, you're like me sitting with the children there, truth and training. And trying to get them to memorize these wonderful words. Romans 12, 2. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. And, and you get the kids singing it, right? Right? And, it just works. And, let that spring to your mind, too. That's me. Now it's out there. Anyone can use that. Get those kids to learn that wonderful verse, we'll have a video of Pastor Jim doing that for kids. Bruce, were you with me that evening when we were doing that? I don't think it was Lori. Anyway, that's besides. We need to go to the table. Lots more on this. I think I probably went into it in greater detail back in that series a few years ago, but we need to conclude there for now. Let me ask Ed to come on up, and we'll get ready to take of these elements. If don't be afraid. If you have something that you just need to drag out into the light, you can't in your heart that you can't take these elements until you do, and you need to make that right. with God, by all means, do it. He longs to hear from you. Lord, we, you know us. You know us. You know our hearts. We don't know our hearts. Maybe to a point we do, but we know what they're capable of to a point, and then, you know, just deceived. Our own minds, you know, our thoughts are so elusive. They're so unpredictable at times. But Lord, you know us. You know us inside and out. Lord, if there's something we need to just bring before you and just drag it and expose it, you know, before your holiness and, you know, your beautiful light, then may it be so. You know, you want us to do that. Lord, help us to confess it within our hearts to you, whatever those thoughts might be, if they've been following an old pattern, if we've been feeding the old nature, if we've been listening to the lies of the enemy, if we've been opening up the door to things that we should really have closed the door to a long time ago. You can help us with all those things. In fact, you've set us free from all of that. You've given us power to overcome that. You've given us victory over all this. We just need to believe it and claim it, you know, and apply this to our lives. Lord, help us as your people to do that. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Ed, if you want to take a moment to pray, appreciate that.
Yeah, Lord, we thank you for being going down on the cross for us and dying for our sin. We just thank you for your blessing that you give us each day, that we can come to you and just ask you for our forgiveness for this sin, because you have forgiven us that sin for the day, tomorrow, and always. We thank you always. Amen.
Spirit gave the apostle the words that he gave to the church, for I received the Lord what I also passed on to you. Now the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of." Those old thoughts attached to that old nature, he took them. They're gone. They're buried.
Yes.
we need them no longer. You know, his precious blood spilled so that we can be free.
Amen.
I want to pray. Thank you so much.
Yes, Father, we thank you. This is Jim said that you shed your blood that we might have freedom from the sin and death of eternity. We just ask you to be with us today, to continue to give us that blessing of freedom that your blood was shed for us. Amen.
the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Amen. Lord, thank you for the minds you've given us. Thank you for the encouragement, Lord, that we can take captive some thoughts and dispose of them, and we can choose to think on things that are good, things that are noble, pure, and praiseworthy, things that will really truly make a difference in this world, because it points to you, and you transform lives. As you transform ours, may we continue to be transformed. May we be a people who daily repent and change our minds, turn from the things of this world, and look to you. It's a great army that we're up against, but you are greater, and you've given us victory, and we thank you for it. So be with your people, continue to strengthen us and empower us to do all that you've called us to do, and may our lives truly resemble yours. May we be a people who understand what it is to have the mind of Christ, and let the power of that just flow and work in our lives. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.